Tech Team. Orlando Arena was the scene of a shocker last year when the United States selects upset the Soviet team 5-2. Last night, the Soviets got some revenge. This team from Riga in the Republic of Latvia. But if the United States pulls even at the end of tonight's game, they go to 10-minute sudden death overtime. If that doesn't do it, they go to a shootout, soccer style, which the purists hate, but can be mighty exciting. Arthur Irbe is in goal. He is unbeaten with this team, 4-0-1 on the tour, and was brilliant last night. He kept his team in the game much of period two. Chad Erickson from Minnesota Duluth is the goalie for the United States. He's a junior. He played very, very well in last night's game as well. So we're all set to go. Is McGeckren on the faceoff, playing it inside the Soviet zone, as the United States will take to the offense early and try to get that goal back in a hurry, John. They almost had a chance right there, broken up by number six, Karch. For the Soviets, brings it over the blue line, but the dangerous Tony Amati is right there, trying to feed McGeckren. He has LeClaire with him on the wing, can't get it to him, and the Soviets are pressured early, backpedaling much of the opening seconds of the second game. Amati now gets it across for LeClaire, who shoots it wide, past McGeckren. On the near boards, the beleaguered Soviets taking time, clearing, now moving out of the zone to center ice. Coming down the right side is Snarok, couldn't get a good shot away. Narok in the corner battling for it. LeClaire comes in there, gets some help from his teammate David Tredowitz. And the Americans have cleared the zone. Now they bring it away. Dowd is on the ice. Makes a pretty pass, and he almost found his winger, Naparella, just missing him by a foot or so. Shooting off for the Soviet Union is checked in the corner. Soviets come up with it. Good forechecking by Dowd just fails. Number four, Jim Mahar, assaulted Rock on defense last night. Gets it ahead to Breslin. Breslin down. Breslin's shot blocked on the defense. Rebound is loose, but now it comes back to center.
A strong beginning for the Americans, getting to most loose pucks. They're also reading the pass plays the Soviet defensemen are trying so far, especially Amante during his first shift.
Rink-wide pass is too far for Alexander Belyevsky. It is called icing. A face-off back in the Soviet zone. Scoreless about a minute and a half in period one of game two. For the United States, Larkin will take the face-off. He's got Ronan on his right, Harkins on his left. The defense players for the United States are Sasarsky on the left side. And on the right side is Gorman, they're both from Princeton.
Number five, Larkin, Don, moves from left wing to center ice for this game because of the LeClaire change to the McGeckren line.
For the Soviet Union, Tomanis can't control the puck. Over on the far side, kept in by Leonid Berezhnev. Larkin up the boards, fails to clear. Long shot, rebound. Erickson jams it away just in time to the blue line. The Soviets manage to keep it in. Now the United States will clear to center ice. Tomanis with it for the referee, and American Matt Dunn is made the first call of the night as he comes across to the penalty box.
And it's an interference call. So Mike Sertich and his club will start on the power play as this game is just over 2 minutes old. Matt Dunn makes the call. The Soviet player appeals somewhat. Can't quite see Dunn, who got the penalty.
Seems a little bit puzzled to be in there. It is number 11, Oleg Znarok.
Znarok. It's an interference call in the neutral zone. There is Znarok knocking down Harkins away from the puck. So the Americans feel the first goal is very critical in this game because it is a two-game total goal situation. They trail by two starting this one. Here's a great example or great possibility for them to get the first one as they are on the power play.
And they put the McGeckren line on the ice. Here's the defenseman rushing up to Vita, but it's called offside of the blue line, so the faceoff will come just outside early in the United States power play.
The Americans today only had Chris Nelson and backup goaltender Tom Cole practice. The rest of the team came down and checked out their sticks, etc. The Soviet club did not practice. They took all their equipment outside, put it on the grass underneath the palm trees, and let the sun do the work.
The Florida sunshine. It. Works it. Miracle. In they come now. LeClaire got bumped in time, makes the pass. Amante shoots. He scores!
play goal for Team USA to open the scoring. Amonte did not panic and shoot from a long distance. When he gets the puck, watch how he decides not to shoot right here. So he moves in. The screen set up and it ricochets off of the defenseman's leg. I believe that's Chudinov in front, and it will ricochet there off of his ankle in behind Archer's Herbe. 1-0 Team USA. And Tony Amonte, who was ejected in game one of this series, starts this game as the hero.
Amonte is back, and so is the United States team, within one now. It's 4-3 in this total goal series that began 4-2 in the scoreboard. The Soviets could not contain the Americans, who desperately wanted to get that first goal and got it on the power play. Here they come back again. Rod Taylor brings it in. Taylor turning out, leaves the puck there, gets bumped off it, drops it back for Nelson. His shot, rebound in front. It's loose in front of the Soviet goal. They bang away at it. Still loose. A penalty's going to be called now. The Soviets bring it out, and there will be a cross-checking call in front of the net. So feelings running high here. Nelson mixing it up with the Soviet player Zanarok, who just came out of the penalty box. His penalty responsible for the first goal.
Here's the point shot from the Americans. Nelson, it's a shot that's redirected to save, and in front, Chudinov, number 7, will take the penalty. They call it cross-checking as the Americans drive to the net. Now, after the whistle, you see some of the pushing and shoving. That's Zanarok, who moved out of the penalty box. And it's another power play for Team USA. Now, the Soviet team this morning had a meeting amongst themselves with their coaching staff and noted that the referee was not a Soviet referee. It's an American referee. They better be careful and stay out of the penalty box. And they've been in there now twice, and we're just over 3 minutes into this game. Now, at center ice, Kotlops, or Belyavsky, pardon me, who can speak English, was just talking to the referee, I suspect, to plead his case.
Yes, a couple of these Soviet players speak very good English. Defenseman Ulvis Ketlaps, you might have heard last night in particular. The Soviet coach is Ivo Zgrabovsky. He already reps in Zygard Sultsevich are his assistants, and that's where we stand in this series. It is just halftime now, starting the second half tonight, and the Americans have done what they had to do, many felt. That was score first. The linesman, Jerry Domont, the other linesman, Doug Wilson, Domont over explaining something to the Soviet coach. We've seen his team take two potentially, certainly one is, costly early penalties.
Uh-oh.
So what happened after the initial call is going to hurt the United States. Nelson now gets a misconduct.
And he is gone. Or 10 minutes, pardon me, a 10-minute misconduct. Now Matt Dunn, the referee, has gone back to the timekeeper's bench to discuss things.
He gave him a headbutt, apparently, is the call by the referee. Nelson did. He's also off for slashing along with number 7 of the Soviets, Chudinov.
Oh, there's Nelson throwing the stick away. Anyway, actually, it's a 4-on-3 situation here, Don, so the Americans do have the power play.
Indeed they do. DeVita, who scored a goal last night, gets it back to Dowd. He lets the shot go through a maze, just steered away in time by Arthur Irbe, the all-star goalie in the World Championships last year for the Soviet Union. The Americans with a chance to pull this series dead even now with an early second power play goal. Irbe behind the goal, tries to clear. Dowd on the near boards as DeVita settles back toward the point. Number 23 is Breslin for the United States. He battles for it unsuccessfully. Belyavsky for the Soviet Union can't get it out. Dowd now tries to find some room. DeVita standing wide open in front by himself. Can't get the puck to him now. Here's a slashing call from referee Matt Dunn.
Another penalty against the Soviet Dynamo Riga team. Now, what we've been told is Chris Nelson was ejected for headbutting, so he's gone. The American team now down to 5 defensemen. And the Americans here get another power play, Don. Lots of power play time here. Soviets are somewhat miffed. Matitsyn takes a slashing call right across the arm with the stick up high.
Repeatedly,
absolutely. And you see the arm shooting up from the referee. So it's still a 4-on-3. And then the Americans will have a 2-man advantage. So this is a great opportunity for Team USA to tie this thing up.
John McGeckren on the draw. He's got Amonte with him. Sarsky on defense, along with number 7, Sean Gorman, as they backpedal. Interesting how the Soviets are taking the cheap, silly kind of penalties that American and Canadian teams once were accused of. Gorman inside the line now as they work at four attackers against three. Sasarsky plays it down for Amati, takes it back on the far point. They play catch with it down the way the Soviets like to do in their power play. Now the shot from Sasarsky, and that's turned away by Irbe. Sasarsky has it slipped through, race for the puck. Soviets try to get a fast break here shorthanded. Here's the pass, it hits the goalpost. Great scoring chance there off the goalpost by Siplikov. Gorman, Sasarsky. A scare for the United States right there. Sasarsky from Princeton brings it in, but the Soviets come up with it once again and kill off more valuable time. As Narok now will backpedal into his own zone.
Soviets will think offense all the time. You can't relax even though you're on the power play. The Americans did a little, and that was close. Siplikov hit the goal post with a quick wrist shot.
A missed pass by Mahar shoots it down. The ice touch back there by the goaltender. He clears it himself. Irbe right out over the blue line. Americans need some cohesiveness here with a marvelous second scoring opportunity. Out of the box comes one penalized player, Shudinov. And they're even at strength.
Right, now four on four.
Here's a chance for Naparella. Couldn't get much wood on that. In behind the net is Jay Moore, number 16. Soviets again, head man the puck. Here's a break for them coming in. Belyavsky steers it just off target. Pounded from behind as he tried to release the shot.
DeVita,
a great chance wasted there.
DeVita, the defenseman, came back and didn't allow Belyavsky to get the clean shot.
Naparella leaving it there for Jim Larkin. Larkin, big, sturdy hockey player, loses his feet and regains his momentum and carries on in behind the net. Snarok watching him in there for the Soviet Union. They battle away for possession. Larkin refuses to give up. Now the Soviets take over. Narok checked by a determined Larkin. Played about 6 minutes here. The only goal of the night, which brings the U.S. to 2-1, has been scored, and the United States will take a penalty here. Jim Larkin, out of frustration, probably with all that scrumming that went on him there, finally takes down a Soviet player and will pay the price.
Larkin forechecking and throwing the body a couple of times. He then gets caught putting his stick there. The Soviet player jumps up, went over, down he went, so Larkin's in the penalty box. So it's now a 4-on-3, aside from the goaltender's power play, for Team Dynamo Riga.
For the United States, you mentioned just two defensemen, Predowitz and DeVita out there, along with a real plugger, Ed Ronan. So valuable killing penalties last night. 4 attackers to 3 for the Soviet Union. A chance for them to regain the 2-goal lead they had starting this night. Bring it across, number 7, Shudinov, from the right point.
Remember, they like to set up number 5 for the big shot. He's got the best shot in the Soviet Union, so it's said.
Narok playing it back. Shudinov gets it over on the far side. And they'll simply pay catch. Now the wide-angle shot goes wide. There's a hard blast that John Davidson referred to. Off target. U.S. getting fresh bodies out there to try to kill those penalties. Narok brings it ahead, spearheads the play to center ice for the Soviet Union. Karch takes the pass off the boards, into the corner he goes. Being watched in there by Tredowitz for the United States. Narok plays it beside the goal. Good check made there, and golfed down the ice by Gorman. Sean Gorman from Princeton makes a big play. Soviets now with a 5-3 advantage, a big advantage over the Americans here. Chudinov shoots. Erickson makes the save, and they clear the zone. Alexander Karch for the Soviet Union. Got it back to Belyavsky. Shudinov. Now the big shot. Glove saved by Erickson with a hard blast from Zanofia.
You can see, John, the same pattern for Dynamo Riga on the power play. They'll get the puck down towards Chad Erickson's goal. Then they feed the defenseman. There's the puck deep. Now it goes back. And as we mentioned, they love to set up for that particular shot. A great save, a real strong save by Erickson, who's looked very calm and very good to this point. He's got an interesting goal stick. His blade is curved inward. He has to cross his hands, Don, when he handles the puck, and that in turn allows him to flip the puck up. So when he puts it flat, it curves back towards his body. It's the first time I've ever seen that. Most goaltenders that have to change hands with their stick will use a straight blade to handle a puck. Very interesting concept.
Maybe a curved goal stick will increase the goal production from goalies as time goes on. Power play, well, the Soviets on this tour have not been very effective, just 3 for 27.
And you know, over in the Soviet Union, in the Elite League, this power play is the best ranked power play of all the Elite League teams. So they're a little miffed at how they haven't been able. I think it's a smaller ice surface. There you see the officials. Matt Dunn, by the way, is from Atlanta, Georgia.
Dahlman, Doug Wilson are the linesmen again tonight, as they were last evening. Soviets trying to cash in on a power play here. The United States quite easily clears. And a white wave returns inside the blue line. Chudinov now getting across to Matisson. Bandul relays it in front. Second chance, slap shot. Pass beside the goal instead. Back out here to Grigoriev. There's a hard blast. Erickson gets wood on that. Back on the ice for the United States come Harkin, so they're only a man short now. Matitsa getting it across to Gregoria. Another man on for the United States. Harkin, they're at full strength, and the United States has weathered a double hand advantage for the Soviet Union. One by one, they're back at full strength, but Gekrin lets a weak shot go, and the Americans will change on the fly.
When you credit penalty killing, you have to credit the goaltenders. And another penalty now coming up, a tripping call, and this is behind the play, and this Harkin will hurt the Americans, Don, if they keep this up. Harkin's behind the play. He tripped up the Soviet player. Great goaltending by Chad Erickson, especially on a deflection by Bandul. You saw the Soviets with a 5-on-3 work the puck down towards the goaltender. Here's the trip. You'll see Soviet player break away, and then the reach out, and the trip by Harkins in the offensive zone.
There, though, it looked like he might have got his stick caught in his skate. Perhaps not intending to trip the Soviet player, but Matt Dunn calls it. Harkins off at 8:31. So having just weathered a couple of penalties, the United States now must endure another Soviet power play.
Last night we talked about Archer's ear bay and his fine goaltending against Mike Sertich's team. He was a story in the first period. Here so far, Chad Erickson's been the story. The penalty-killing goaltending that he's given Team USA has been exceptional.
Breaking up the right wing is Evgeny Samaryak for the Soviet Union. Number 11 in there also. Znarok's got an awful lot of ice time tonight. For the United States, Sasarsky at center ice. Tries to play it in the neutral zone to his teammate Taylor. Can't get it to him. Znarok again is everywhere. Back inside his own line. 9-minute mark now. 1-0 in the game. 4-3 Soviets in the series. Soviet player falling across the blue line. United States trying to clear it quickly. Fanning on the puck. Now trying to sweep it back to the neutral zone. And the Soviets maintain possession. Over to Chudinov, the defenseman on the right point. Down to Samaryak. Chudinov across, here is the shot. Block, Erickson's down, rebound, they score. Second chance pays off for the Soviet Union. And we're tied at one. It was Alexander Karch, number 6, tapped it in from the crease.
Chad Erickson, the goaltender, read the play nicely. He knew that the Soviets would try again to set up Zinovyev for the shot. They did. Erickson made the save, but in front, Karch was able to tap it in. There's that setup play, and you see the blast down low. It's a 2-on-2 in front, but just barely, Karch was able to knock the puck in behind. There's the save. The puck ricocheted a little bit. Nearly another great save by Chad Erickson. Karch and his teammate jammed up in front as the Soviets continue just to use the point shot as their primary power play play.
Soviets have outshot the Americans 8-3 now, tied 1-1 on the night, and have reinstated a two-goal lead, 5-3, in this total goal series. We're approaching the halfway mark of period one here in Orlando, Florida tonight. That's the score in the game right now, game two. Soviet wave comes into the United States zone again. Erickson will clear it himself over the blue line, and the Americans will start up again. They play in the neutral zone. Number 30 missed the pass to the right side, and it's padded layoff. It's called offside, or icing it is, back for a faceoff of the Soviet zone.
We've just seen the goaltender in this last shift handle the puck twice. Watch how he, see how he crossed hands, Don? Now all of a sudden that curve is facing the proper way so he can move it off ice quickly. So what he is actually is a right-handed shot. If he was a left-handed shot, he could put the catching glove down on the bottom of the stick just like that, but he's not. He has to switch hands, a right-handed shot. So that's why he's got the curve going in the opposite direction.
He did so effortlessly. For the United States, David DeVita. He got one of the two goals last night. McEachran got the other in the 4-2 loss to the Soviets. They keep it in. Here is the hard shot wide from Brett Harkins from Bowling Green. And the Soviets bring it back inside the United States zone. Tonana's bumping in the corner there as they whistle it down inside the United States blue line.
Done some interesting talk regarding the 92 Olympics for Team USA. There's some speculation that former Olympian, and he was on the 1980 team, Mark Pavlich, would like to come back and maybe give it a shot to play once again. Tremendous talent who retired early from playing hockey, living in the state of Minnesota. It'll be interesting to see if he can make a comeback.
Indeed, hard shot, stop of the blocker of Erickson. That came from the stick of the Soviets, Volovchenko. This is DeVita trying to clear, getting some help from behind the goal from Brett Harkins. Good body work by DeVita. Larkin picks it up, and he'll make the pass ahead of the center ice area in the stick of Harkins. Harkins tries the right wing side, feeds Larkin the shot, turned away by Urbe. For the Soviet Union, Leonid Berezhnev out to center ice, quickly back inside the line once again. Soviets regroup, both teams changing on the go. Pass ahead by Berezhnev, intercepted, the United States with it. Gorman, Mahar, left there for Taylor. Taylor's shot goes wide. Sean Gorman down the right boards, keeps it in play. Taylor fell, got tangled up in behind the net, couldn't locate the puck. Kadyavsky, long lead pass inside the blue line, offside for Boldovchenko. Good, exciting end-to-end action here. We have seen wide-open hockey, the kind of hockey these fans really enjoy the last two nights.
A lot of power play action once again. Chad Erickson very strong. Shots on goal, 10-4, the majority of those shots by the Dynamo Riga team on the power play, especially during that two-man advantage. Here you see the shot as Larkin winds up, and Yerbe not only makes a save, but he put the rebound into the corner. Yerbe was wearing a Minnesota North Star golf shirt.
Must be getting serious about today, signing. Yeah. He was drafted by them a couple of years ago. A lot of these Soviets wearing various NHL sweatshirts around the hotel today. Into the corner, LeClaire for McGeckren, couldn't get it to him. Volchenko clears it for the Soviet Union. Belyavsky, the big right winger, gets turned around by Amate. Tony Amate now always a threat. Pirouettes, he goes inside the blue line, looks for the puck just in behind him. Jabbing away at the Soviet player, he'll take a cheap penalty right there. He did not have to dig and slash like that, but Amate will take 2 minutes for his trouble.
Actually, I think that penalty was coming up prior to that, Don. It's an elbowing call against the Soviet player as Amante was nearly nailed at the blue line.
Back in a moment.
Here's after the play where Amante went back at one of the Soviet players, Grigoryev. Grigoryev is in the penalty box. He tried to nail Amante at the blue line with an elbow. Amante just moved across, got around it. Here's the penalty. See the elbow coming? Ooh, man. Maybe he did catch Amante. The referee caught the play, I'll tell you that. Power play time for Team USA.
And Somadi did well not to have an offsetting penalty called for his retaliation. 5-3 is the total goal score of the series. 7:40 to go in the first period of game two. Here's a chance now. Dowd steers it in front. Still loose in the zone. And Pratowitz couldn't catch up with it.
Now you have to be aware of the Soviets. If they get the puck in their zone, even though they're killing a penalty, they'll try that long up-ice pass for the breakaway.
Dowd for Breslin. Tried to relay it short side. Couldn't get good wood on it. Alexander Karp. She has got the goal for the Soviets tonight. Plays it inside the line as the team from Latvia. Dynamo Riga changes on the move. Dowd still on the ice against Ketleps down the right boards. Can't get enough Pavlov for the United States. Or for the Soviet Union, with Kersh circling in the neutral zone. They complete their change now, as do the Americans.
The Dowd line goes off, and the McEachern line comes right back on. Both the McEachern line and the Dowd line have scored a power play goal in this series.
And here comes David Tretowitz from Clarkson University, lobbing it down to the Soviet corner. Overskated in behind the net by Amante. Much of a sustained attack for the United States at this juncture. Amante will try to fire it up as he'll bring it to the blue line inside. Here's the pass to LeClaire. LeClaire brings it back to Amante at the slot. Shooting and blocked right in front by Irbe. For the USSR, Sleeplikov brings it in. He gets all turned around, twisted around by Sikarski. Soviets continue to change on the move. 6 minutes to go in the first period. 5-3 total goals, the lead for the USSR. Even in tonight's game, at one.
2-for-9, the Americans are on the power play in this series, and you see they may be 2-for-10 in about 5 seconds.
Sikarski, long shot down to that Soviet corner, is too high and goes over the glass.
Got only one good scoring chance, and that was a slap shot. Did you see the celebration? A slap shot from the high slot by Tony Amonte, and everything was set up perfect for him because Irbe, the goaltender, was screened. However, somehow the Riga netminder was able to make the save. Here's the play where the puck from Leclerc goes back to Amonte. You'll see everybody jam up in front. Terrific shot, but Irbe, noted as the best goaltender in Europe and one of the best in all the world, makes the save.
That is the power play story on five of them, just 3 shots on goal, but they have scored once, the Americans, on the power play. But 5.5 minutes to go in the first period. 5-3 total goals, USSR leading the United States. Fredowitz. Here it's steered ahead now to number 22, Harkins, for the United States. Got Ronan with him. They leave it there. Soviets bring it back down the ice. From the left side, hard shot, turned way back by Erickson, right to the blue line. Tomanis. Is out there with Alexiev. They play it ahead for Boltoshenko. Down on the corner. Tapping on the boards is Gorman. Tomanis goes in to help for the Soviet Union now. Ronan flips it ahead and gets it out of the zone.
The Soviets attacking a little more than I thought they would. The plan originally was to lay back somewhat. You see them dump the puck in here for a change now. Now they're playing that system, Don. They're moving back into the neutral zone and looking for a turnover. The Americans trying to change now.
Beliavsky makes a pretty play right in front, and it's in the net. Number 14 scores it. Sergei Boltoshenko.
Boltoshenko fed off the fact that the Americans were making a change. They changed the puck. They changed lines without getting the puck past center ice, and they got trapped. This Riga team, a very experienced hockey club, took advantage of a hockey club that was put together 4 days ago. Boltoshenko with a great, Beliavsky, pardon me, a great pass to Boltoshenko, and the goal, a calm play. Here's the Americans, you see, cutting over to the right side to make the change. Two quick passes, and the Soviets take care of that late change. And you see how much time that Boltoshenko had, and it's a goal.
The Americans try to maintain some pressure inside the Soviet zone, can't do so. It's as though the Soviets said, well, no need to sit back on this lead. If it's going to be a shootout, we think we could win it. And tonight they are at 2-1. As offensive hockey continues, 6-3 now in the series for the USSR total goals. Moore looking forward to the Soviet zone as the Soviets easily bring it up. Beliavsky now will go to the bench. Complete change for the Soviet Union as Mahar brings it ahead for Taylor at the blue line, but not inside. Now shot down by Mahar in behind the USSR goal, and the Americans change on the move with one forechecker, Amati, on the ice. Leclerc now comes out to join him with Begecker. Harsh. And a hard shot just missed by number 11's Narok. McGekin finally clears the zone, tries to feed it ahead to Amonte. Delayed offside now, is enforced at the blue line. With 3 minutes and 25 seconds remaining in the first period, on the series, the Soviets lead by 3, 2-1 in tonight's game. Don Chevrier along with John Davidson, Paul Kennedy with you in Orlando in the arena where the Soviet Union, wide open hockey, is taking a 2-1 lead tonight on a 6-3 lead overall against this United States select team in the wind-up game of this mini-series here in the sunshine of Florida. That was just out over the blue line and back in again. Called on the offside by the linesman, Wilson.
Don, the American staff watching this series as they look ahead to 92 for Albertville, certainly watch the players when they're winning games and they watch the players when they're losing games, to try and see exactly what these players have as far as leadership goes and how they react with adversity. And with the team trailing by 3 in this two-game series, staff will watch closely.
Amati goes down against the boards. It's the penalty minutes so far in the series. you're going to be in Albertville in 92, and I hope you need to know that you might have to bring an Alpine hook to go to work to get up the hill. They jam away at the side of the net, airbase down, and the play is stopped. He got a glove on it just in time as they mill around and push and shove on his doorstep and in behind now.
This was an example as Kekkonen works over, or pardon me, make that Amonte working over Katlops. It's an example of why they wanted LeClair on this line, who's so big and strong. When the Americans work the puck on the backboards, finally, because of their strength and tenacity, put the puck in front where they nearly scored. LeClair, with his size, really helped generate the play. Kekkonen will get a penalty. There's LeClair along the backboards. He takes a couple of solid hits, but he's still able to move the puck in front. Amonte's there. Kekkonen comes in late. The Americans try, but Archer's Yerbe was there. There's Kekkonen pushing down the player. That's why he's in the penalty box.
So the net result of that melee around the Soviet goal, offsetting roughing penalties to Igor Pavlov of the Soviet visiting team, and to Sean Kekkonen from Boston U for the United States.
Now it looks like there's another Soviet player moving across to the penalty box, Don, so maybe it's a power play situation. Actually, we look, it looks like there's two players from each team in the penalty box. Our apologies, it's very difficult here to try and get...
The goalie got a penalty, apparently Irbe, and Irbe. the Soviet player will sit it out for him.
So it's 3-on-3. This could be wide open now. You know, a lot of people talking about Archer's Earbag joining Minnesota. And if the Olympic situation is such that NHL players are not allowed to play in the Olympics, I think a lot of people will be very happy that Earbag may be in North America while the Olympics are on. They say that the Soviet Union may have trouble in goal if Earbag does not play.
Well, traditionally, they were carried by Tretiak for so many years, and before and since, they have struggled for outstanding goaltending. He finally gave it to them in the spring at the World Championships. So he gets a slashing penalty, also for the Soviet Union. Igor Pavlov gets the roughing call, and the other penalties to LeClair, along with Kekkonen, two-minute minors. And they battle away on Irbe's doorstep once again, as Dowd gets turned away, frustrated. Jim Dowd from Lake Superior State. That school has sent four players to this U.S. Selects team.
High expectations for him, Don. He's a legitimate Hobie Baker Award candidate this season.
Here is Kwedowicz. Makes the pass. Dowd circling. Makes his move now and couldn't quite get it on the stick of DeVita. Two defensemen out there. One of them can score. DeVita proved that last night. Here is Alexander Karch for the Soviet Union. Stopping with Chudinov inside the blue line. The dangerous Zinoviev taken down heavily on the play. Goes Karch. DeVita brings it up the right boards. Three attackers each. In front of the goalies on the ice right now, so you can look for some real wide open play. Dowd almost made the check in behind the net. United States will change on the go now. Tired Dowd will go to the bench, as the Soviets also make player changes. Less than 2 minutes to go in the first period. Soviets have widened their series lead to 3-6. Four checking for the Americans is Smedden. Wins the puck, getting it back to Jim Mahar. Foreman on the right side. Again, two defensemen, one attacker for the United States. Kudryavsky will accept the pass over on the left side of the ice and now bring it forward for the Soviet Union. Haven't seen much of Van Duel tonight. He scored two goals last night. Big attacker for the Soviet Union. Center man, there's Belyavsky. Shot at Erickson on the rebound. A second fine stop for the United States.
Once again, Belyavsky showing some skills. He told us that he feels, as a 26-year-old, he's the best-kept secret in the entire Soviet Union regarding hockey. Saw a fine cut to the forehand side. He's got the puck, and then he'll just take off immediately, right out of the starting blocks. Now watch his cut to the left there, as he shows strength, knocks down a player, gets his shot. It was Sean Gorman who went down.
Play in the neutral zone, a little over a minute to go in the opening period. Bereznev chasing it back in his own zone. Giving way now to Sitlikov. At the end of the final minute we go. 6-3 total score in the series favoring the Soviet Union. Their two-goal lead has been widened by an extra tally tonight. Sarsky has four players come on the ice, two from each team, so we're back to full strength now for both sides. Suddenly he looks crowded out there by comparison. 30 seconds to go. Pavlov accepts the pass at the United States blue line. Can't get around Sikarski, and it's back to center ice. Reznev played it across for number 12, Sipnikov. Kredowitz rink wide for the United States. Seemingly content to let it run out here. And regroup for period two. One more chance for Pavlov over the Soviets, and Erickson makes a fine stop on that. Rebound is shot wide. 2 seconds to go in the period, and that'll do it for the opening frame here in Orlando as the Soviet Union widens its lead over the United States. 4-2 victors last night. They've taken a 2-1 lead in the first period of the second game for a 6-3 overall advantage. And good goaltending at both ends, certainly by this man, Irbe, and by Erickson, the key to the performance so far tonight.
Club, this is a club that has been together for a long period of time. It's a strong, well-coached hockey club that can adapt to different styles of play. They've done that quite a bit. They can be predictable at times, and for Mike Sertich and his club, they need a strong second period. We talked last night about Mike Sertich, Don, scoring one goal when he played college hockey. He scored it against Tony Esposito, who was playing goal for Michigan Tech. That shot that he actually scored on was a shot that deflected off of his leg in past Tony Esposito, went off his shin pad. Mike Sertich says he still got the shin pad as a souvenir.
It's probably mounted somewhere
That's
in his
it.
Rec room. Oleg Zdarok for the Soviet Union backpedaling now as they come forward to begin the second period. The centerman, Vyacheslav Fandul, only had one shift of the first period, but he starts the second period here. He was used an awful lot last night.
An offside call here against Team USA, so the faceoff comes outside the Soviet blue line.
The Americans with the dangerous combination of LeClaire, McEachern, and Amonte, their starting line.
It's been interesting watching this Soviet club handle the aggressive play by Team USA. The Dynamo Riga team, who we're watching here, is one of the more physical teams that plays in the Soviet Elite League, so they were pretty much well prepared for this style of play.
McEachern makes a good check. Shooting off for the Soviets, tries to recover. Forecheck by LeClaire in the corner, feeding McEachern. He hounds it in behind the net, back for LeClaire. These two forecheckers playing catch in there. Now here's a centering pass for Amade. Couldn't quite get it to him from McEachern, and the Soviets bring it back out. Oleg Zdarok, he got a lot of first period ice time. LeClaire checks him. U.S. changing already. 55 seconds into the period. LeClaire swings by the Soviet player, then a delayed reaction goes down, lost the puck. Bolovchenko for the Soviets, he couldn't control it. Inside the line. This is Sarsky. Dowd it is trying to center it out. Dowd over on the far boards will backhand it in behind the net for Jeff Naparella. Heavy hitting going on the early seconds of this period. Here's the pass for Mahar. Couldn't get it to him. Naparella looking for a chance in front as well. Number 23 takes a hit. Breslin from the Soviet player Grigoriev. Sweeping it around in front, trying to jam it in. Breslin's taken down hard. There'll be a penalty on that. Number 21 took him down. Grigoriev.
Great shift for Breslin. Dowd and Naparella. Dowd in particular. You see his level of play getting better as this series moves along. Power play coming up. Team USA. You see the backboard work, good stick save by Irbe, then the penalty, which is against Grigoriev. And later, there was some more pushing and shoving, and Matitsin has been sent to the penalty box, so we could have a 5-on-3. There's Grigoriev in the box, and there's Matitsin. He's in with him. The referee had a discussion with Belyavsky once again, so he could go over and explain it to the Soviet coaching staff, as Belyavsky speaks both languages. So 5-on-3 coming up, Don. Another critical portion of this game. Dowd's line with Breslin and Napriella were just terrific during that shift to draw these penalties.
Matitsin got a butt-ending penalty. You don't see that very often after the hooking call in Gregoria.
So he gets...
He got a 10-minute misconduct as well.
Interesting. The linesman, by the way, made that second call, a butt-end call on Matitsin.
Well, again, we hark back to what we said in the first period, John. That's the cheap, unnecessary kind of penalty that U.S. teams used to be accused of. Now the Soviets making some bad mistakes here.
It's nice when you see them get caught at the sneaky stick work, which they have been noted for years and years and years.
Exactly.
You love it when the men in stripes are able to detect those types of plays.
Well, years ago, some of the dirtiest hockey I ever saw back in the 60s and 70s was the Czechs and the Soviets. Well, it was brutal.
They don't like each other a whole lot, do they?
Back on the point, Trotter whips with a two-man advantage power play for the United States. We'll whip it around now. DeVito with it. Defenseman down in the corner. They play it in behind the net for Dowd. Napparelli is stationed right in front of goaltender Irbe. Here's the shot from DeVito. Sails high over top. In the corner, Tim Breslin with it from Lake Superior State. DeVito back to Trotterwitz, right point. Makes the shot, makes the pass down in the corner instead. Breslin, round for Dowd. Napparelli still circling. Here's a chance now for Napparelli, and instead of shooting, Trotterwitz made the pass. Didn't quite click. Soviets bring it back down the ice. Zinoviev killing a few seconds off now.
Team USA wants Dowd to handle the puck as much as possible in the offensive zone. He's such a fine playmaker. Let him be the quarterback.
Here he is. Dowd going almost all the way in. Just turned back at the last second when he met Brezhnev. Takes the shot. Americans wise. He's taking their time on this. Oh, a bad break there. It hopped over Trotterwitz's stick and back to the neutral zone.
C-Team USA does not have a big point shot like the Soviets have. That number five, Zinoviev, with that cannon. Team USA trying to work it down low, knowing that they don't have a big, big cannon, a great shooter from the point.
David DeVito from Lake Superior State got a goal last night for the United States. Feeds LeClaire now as the big attacking unit comes on. McGeckrin, Amati, and LeClaire for the United States. This is number 11, Tony Amati with it. He gets turned back for the forechecking of Vladimir Siplikov, the Soviet right winger. LeClaire now will start it up again. Time running out of this two-man advantage power play for the Americans. LeClaire jamming it down the left boards. And the Soviet easily clear. Erickson all the way up over two lines. Makes an offside pass to McGeckrin. It'll be whistled down. Face up way back beside the American goal.
Team USA have not registered a shot during this power play. And not to make excuses, but when you put a team together in short order, little things make a difference, such as you have not had opportunities to work power play plays. You have not been able to make quick, concise line changes, which has cost this Team USA a goal in this game. Mike Sertich would love to take a month to work with this squad of talent, and then you'd see a much sharper power play.
He could do wonders if he had that time, to be sure. On the right side, this is Gorman, the defenseman, plays it right in front, and Larkin almost jammed it in, just tipped it wide. Two Soviets back on the ice now. They have weathered a double power play disadvantage. Larkin down in the corner. Pressure continues for the United States. Here's a chance in front. Good quick shot turned aside for the stick of Ed Ronan as it was deflected just wide. Ronan forechecking in there, trying to break the play up. Soviets shoot it down the ice. Relayed. Icing is waved off of the linesman. A little over 4 minutes into the second period. 6-3 on the series. The Soviets lead. 1-4-2 last night. Mahar with it. For Harkins inside the line. Try to feed Ronan. Backhanded in by number 7, Sean Gorman from Princeton. For the Soviet Union, Ari Vito Lynch. Not getting much action tonight. Gets a shift now, however, jamming it in beside. Konstantin Grigoryov with it. Gets dumped in the corner by Harkins. And that is whistled down as the Soviet player is flattened his back and the linesman come to his rescue. Nothing much will come of this. 2-1 the score in tonight's game. 6-3 in the series.
There's Harkins moving into the corner with his stick up, the body check, and it's a cruncher. He continued to work over the Soviet player, knocking him down. And the referee watched it all and decided that Dynamo Riga will go on the power play.
Brad Harkins from Bowling Green in the Orlando Arena penalty box.
Now,
however,
both players get penalties. My, oh, my.
Konstantin Grigoryev. A lot of that has happened tonight. Referee Matt Dunn has offset them. So Bereznev, they give a roughing call too. And again, no power play advantage. The status is quo, just past the 5 minute mark of the period.
This American squad, when they arrived in Orlando to practice for 2 days prior to this two-game tournament, spent some time working with the youth hockey here in Orlando. About 200 kids showed up, and these young men went out, showed them some hockey skills. Even was a three-year-old out there, I understand, who had to use his hockey stick to hold himself up. But the kids representing Team USA had some great time with them.
Down the left boards comes David DeVita for the United States. He's alone, however, and gets taken down heavily on the far boards. No penalty on the play. Good clean check. And the Soviets shoot it down the ice. They'll be called for icing with a faceoff back beside their net.
Chad Erickson was talking about the Soviet shots yesterday. He was quite surprised that they challenged his feet a lot last night in the first game of this tournament. They've kept the puck down a lot in this particular game too, as he looks up at the clock. The shots by the Soviets, a lot of times when they first started coming over to the United States, Don, they shot high all the time. They've changed that style somewhat.
And they would shoot seldom, and when they did, they were often high. You're right. Jeff Naparella from Lake Superior State. As it comes all the way back to the United States zone, on the stick now of David Trotowitz from Clarkson University. He gets turned back by the forechecking Soviet player. Narok gets a stick on it, comes back to the neutral zone. Naparella for the Americans. Dowd on his right, can't get it to him. Latvia for the Soviet Union. Next pass to Narok. Held at bay by Naparella. Dow ties up the Soviet attacker. Kerch coming down the right boards. Play a bit scrambly and disorganized at this stage, approaching the 7 minute mark of the second period. Oleg Znarok, Soviet winger, controlling play for the moment, makes the pass to Karch. He makes a bad one at Chudinov out over the blue line. Znarok takes a hit from Ed Ronan from Boston University, right on the penalty bench. Now Ronan comes in and tries to level another Soviet player in the corner. He goes down, gets the puck, and was stick checked at the last second by Irbay, preventing a goal.
Irbay is one of the more active goaltenders from Europe with the goal stick. He's very, very good at it.
Quick with the glove there, the long blast from DeVita.
And you see the good pass he made out of his own zone, which nearly set up a breakaway. The Soviet teams love the up-the-middle breakaway pass. They've tried it once in this game, and it worked for a shorthanded breakaway.
They almost caught Leonid Bereznev coming out of the penalty box.
Another strong ship by Ronan as he takes the body. Boy, there's been some banging. It's a good banging in the two nights by Ed Ronan. In his fourth year at Boston University, a Montreal draft choice, a hard, hard worker. His uncle Ed, with the same name, Ed Ronan, was a player at Providence College in years past. You know, he went and played at Massachusetts for high school hockey at the Phillips Andover Academy. That's where President Bush went.
Loose puck in front, bouncing and cleared by the goaltender Arthur Irbay. Flipped back into the Soviet zone. We're approaching the 8 minute mark now, the second period. Still 6-3 in the series for the USSR over the USA Select. Remember, a team put together by the U.S. Hockey people just 3 days before arriving here in Orlando. Long right wing pass inside the blue line for the Soviet Union. Trying to make the severing pass. They do, right in on top of Erickson. And a golden scoring opportunity turned back there as Grigoryev couldn't pull the trigger.
Good passing by the Soviets, Don. Alexeyev moved in, and I think when he went to make the play, he was hooked just a little bit from behind as he had time to move in and make the play on the goaltender, Chad Erickson. We'll take a look here. There's a little pass. You'll see the late man moving up, the defenseman there, Alexeyev. And you see a little hook from behind that knocked him just off balance, allowing McEachran time to come back and to knock him away from the puck. Secondary effort by the defenseman moving in.
And one shot on goal the entire period. A very strange, scrambly period of hockey here in the Orlando Arena, unlike the other period so far in this competition. Soviet player felt the front of the stick going in, but recovers down in the corner. Cheetson gets bumped off. The puck comes back to the blue line and finally out to center ice. Vladimir Siflikov back with it. And among the spectators, this hard rolling puck goes. Hopefully nobody injured on that. 11:42 remaining in the second period of play. 2-1 in the game for the Soviets. Puck is dropped in the United States zone. 6:45 to go in the second period. Still 6-3 in the series for the USSR. LeClaire in there with Tredowitz for the United States. Grigoriev for the Soviet Union trying to work it in front. American players lost his stick. David Tredowitz, the defenseman. They scramble up the boards. Larkin finally clears the zone for the U.S. Norman Seyus used sparingly by the Soviets on defense tonight. It's a shift now.
Don, we're now seeing the Americans having some trouble getting through the neutral zone as the Soviets are trying to tie up that area.
Fast break by the Soviets, recovering quickly is DeVita for the United States.
That fast break was set up by another pass from Yerbe. He loves to feed the puck up ice.
Not sure if he wants to be a goalie or a playmaker at times.
Well, he sure saves his defensemen a lot of aggravation in their zone as the Americans love to hit and bang. And Yerbe, moving the puck up ice quickly, is trapping those forwards.
Norman Seyus shooting it simply out of the zone, intercepted at center ice by the United States. Now Monte down the left boards. He's McEachran in front, couldn't make the pass. LeClaire tries to help out. Soviets break it up and come back. Down the left side, the weak shot turned aside by Tomanis. Got a big check on him in the corner. Body for checking. Play carries on in the Soviet zone. 5 minutes of change to go here in the second period. Late offside will be the call. So the Americans will change as the Soviets ran out. Left side, Opolsky. Soviet player falling on the play. Alexander Alexeyev keeping it in down the right boards for the USSR. Dowd into check for the United States, number nine. He'll test the waters on the right side. Fails to clear the zone. Tomatas going right in, makes a pass, and it sails over in the far corner. Breslin now, Tim Breslin to center ice for Dowd. Naparella on the left, inside the line they go. Here's the weak little pass, it went nowhere, trickling in behind the Soviet goal. Narok on the ice. Get it ahead for Chudinov. His shot is way wide with Gorman defending. Yaski turning. His shot blocked. Down goes Erickson. Loose puck in front. Caparella down to help smother it and stop the play.
The scoring chance. Oh boy, as the sticks get up. And behind is Karch, who had that scoring chance. And some penalties will be handed out. Karch for sure will get 2 minutes, as will Jim Mahar. The Soviet club was impressed with Mahar's work in the game last night. His aggressiveness, especially killing penalties in front of Erickson. You'll see Karch get the puck here, and he has a whole lot of time. Finally sees he should move ahead. The shot to save, now the action starts. Karch goes for a rebound. A lot of banging in front of Erickson. There's Mahar moving in with Karch. They get their sticks right up. Little shot by Karch, so both of them have been given penalties. So I'm looking forward to 92 with the Olympics. The USA will use four coaches for the Olympics. Dave Peterson, of course, the head coach. Jack Blatherwick is a strength and conditioning coach. He's been hired. They will hire another assistant coach plus a goalie coach who will do video work. And they'll announce this after January 1st of 91 as they try to set up for the upcoming Olympics.
Jim Maher, the American, in the penalty box, along with Alexander Karch of the Soviet Union. 4:05 to go in the second period. It's amazing, as you suggest, how the approach to international Olympic hockey has changed over the years. United States gold medal winners in 1960 and 1980, looking for gold in Albertville in 92. Roughing, offsetting penalties at 15:55, the last two to go to this penalty box in Orlando. Moore makes a check in behind. Quick shot is deflected over top. Might have caught the stick of Sneddon.
It did.
Bounce out of play.
The puck went back to the point men, so the two forwards with this four-on-four action immediately went to the front of Archer's ear bay. And Sneddon did deflect the puck, but it went up high. Sneddon out of the University of Wisconsin, playing for Jeff Sowers in that fine program. See here, four-on-four action. Puck is dumped in by design. Now you'll see the forwards go and work for the puck. Now when it goes back to the point man, watch the forwards drive to the front of the net, and there's the little deflection by Sneddon, who showed some real good speed to get in front.
Moore against Fandula on the drop. Soviet player wins it, but Tietzen tries to get it out of the zone and just barely does, showing some white across that line. Number 19, Dennis Sneddon for the United States. Moore takes the hit, goes down in behind, tries to regain possession. Battling in there with Soviet player Tietzen. Here's the shot by DeVita going wide.
Well, you're sure right about Fandula, who was one of the best players on the ice last night. He's on here again, but he has not been nearly as prominent.
About perhaps his third shift all night. He's out there with Beliavsky, lets the shot go. Erickson on the blocker, makes the save there. Over 3 minutes to go in the period.
Beliavsky, his line mate, has been good. Been very active.
But perhaps not the same without Fandula consistently as his center back. Market for the United States. Soviets are changing out there now. Sieplikoff is on the ice. Pavlov takes the pass. They try to send Sieplikoff inside the blue line. That is whistled down by the linesman Dolmont. 2:39 to go in the second period. 2-1 tonight. 6-3 overall, favoring the team from the Soviet Union. John Chevrier with John Davidson, Paul Kennedy in Orlando at the arena with you. Soviet team continues to hold the edge over the United States. Time running out in the period and in the series for the Americans. 2:30 to go in the second frame. Down the boards goes Grigoriov, gets turned around. Ronan for the Americans. Takes a spill, penalty be called there. Play goes right on. McKechnie with the puck, or it's Larkin with it. Now the Soviets touch it, and the penalty will be put in force by Matt Dunn.
Olvis Katlaps will take the penalty as he reached out with his hockey stick. Hooking's the call. You'll see the American Ronan turns the speed on to the outside. There's Katlaps with the hook, and he takes the penalty. Katlaps, an interesting story. He'd love to stay in the United States and go to the University of Wisconsin. He has a medical problem. He has to have an ankle refractured and repaired, and he'd love to get into some business and perhaps go back to the Soviet Union with a business degree and help build an arena, ice arena. Don Katlaps told us this morning, if there's one difference between the United States people and the Soviet people, he said the Soviets could learn to work harder every day just for society in general. It was very interesting how he said that.
One quick shot from Dow. Now the pass to Kretowicz. Back on the ice come the penalized players, and the Soviets bring it back off the ice. Less than 2 minutes to go. Zanarok with it, dropping the pass back to his point man inside the blue line. They'll be content to come back and kill some time, as Karras, as the Americans now have the man advantage. And they mix it up in the center ice area. Nothing much, it appears, will come of this.
Karch and DeVita got the arms and elbows up. And you see the players looking for the puck. It was fired into the Soviet bench as DeVita forced Karch into the bad clearing play. Not bad play, but errant clearing play.
A minute 46 to go on the period.
Yeah, it was interesting to talk to Katlaps regarding the differences in the societies. He said this country, the cities are so clean and there's so much color. But he said in our society, in the Soviet Union, the people have to work harder to make their society work. It was very interesting to listen to him talk and compare. A year or two ago, they wouldn't talk about anything publicly regarding their own country.
Much more open now, aren't they?
Certainly are.
Often wondered what their thoughts would be. The visiting USSR boxing teams have gone to Las Vegas, walking down the strip, what they must think. There's a lot of us don't know what we think either when we get there. Here's the shot going down to the doorstep of Erickson with a minute 20 to go in the second period. Trying to clear against persistent forechecking and finally gets it past Semeryak. Out there with Znarok, his partner. Semeryak takes it inside the blue line. Soviets not sitting on the lead now, but certainly easing up some valuable time. Americans trying to press now for an extra goal before this period ends. A minute left in it.
Don, the Soviets haven't been trapped this whole period. You can't think of a two-on-one or a three-on-two against them. They played smart.
Here's Dowd. Nice move. Pass in front. Quick shot, and it just sails wide from McClair. Gekrin in the corner. Soviets shoot it down the ice. It's touched. Icing is waved off. 40 seconds to go in the period. Both change on the move as Dowd brings it back up the ice for the United States. Dowd, almost at will, just taking it down to that Soviet corner.
He's
passed back to the point.
He is smooth.
Here's a pass for Amati at his wrong side. Turned around, couldn't find the puck inside. Dowd remains on the ice to McGekin in behind, and Urbe comes out and pokes it away with a stick just in time. And the Soviets get it back to the United States zone. 10 seconds to go as that power play runs out. And that's going to do it for the second period of the second game of this series between Dinamo Riga of the USSR and the United States Selects. The Soviets leading 2-1 tonight, 6-3, will take a 3-goal total goal lead in the final period of play.
Shots after two periods of 17-11, and Yerbe didn't have a lot of work in the period, but he certainly was active with his goal stick, clearing the puck, plus stopping the jams by the USA players around his own goal.
Stay with us, Paul. We'll be back for the intermission in just a moment from Orlando, Florida. Well, I'm sure that this team coached by Mike Sertich will give it all they have as they begin this third period, playing catch-up as they are, down by 3 in the total goal series. For the Soviets, Semeryak in center ice, pushed the puck ahead. His teammate Karsh got taken down heavily. McClair tips it ahead. Zanoffioff for the United States. Can't control Amante, but Amante is forced finally to push it back into the corner. Shooting off against McClair. Soviets bring it back to center ice once again. Pass for Karch. Blocked there by Jim Behar on defense for the United States. DeVita helping out in behind the net. Back to the point. Quick shot sails wide of Erickson. Chopped back into the corner by Grigoriev. LeClaire for DeVita. Inside the line he goes. Dowd trailing in front for the pass. Dowd couldn't get a shot away. Irbe held his ground, and the net comes off its moorings finally as Irbe is pushed back.
We talked during the highlights about the defenseman joining the play. That was DeVita, the defenseman, moving in. Watch Irbe's goal stick. I've mentioned it many times how well he uses it. There he is intercepting the pass, and it would have been a great scoring chance as Dowd was driving to the goal for that chance. Don, he intercepts a lot of passes from the corners. He passes the puck well up ice. He, for a 23-year-old, is a very experienced goaltender, and nothing seems to bother him. During the intermissions, I understand he sits off away from his teammates, sits by himself, puts a cold towel over his head, and just concentrates and thinks about the upcoming job.
He is a seasoned pro, although technically an amateur. Between the pipes for Dinamo Riga. Fast break down the left side here. And good work by Gorman, tying up the Soviet attacker, Bolshenko.
Bolshenko, I think, would have had the clean-cut shot, but when he made the move, he came down and stepped on the puck. And stepping on the puck slowed his progress down.
Breslin dropping it back for Dowd. Now the pack. Pass to Breslin, breaking in. Breslin going around, and Irbe comes sliding out to hold him at bay. Still inside the line, there's Irbe with a pad blocking the blast from Jim Behar. Another shot from the sideboards from Breslin. A shooting gallery for the Soviet goalie, equal to all challenges thus far. Naparella can't control the puck. Petitsin leaves it at the line. Fandul brings it in. Belyavsky, Fandul shoots wide. End to end they go. Fandul takes a stiff check from Taylor of the United States.
John, that last Soviet rush was a 4-on-2 Soviet rush, and that will happen when you trail by 3 goals in the last period. You have to think offense. The Americans are. They will get trapped somewhat this period, so Erickson will have to come up real strong.
Taylor almost stole the puck, but Opolsky recovers for the Soviet team. U.S. forechecking well in the neutral zone, trying to force a break. Unsuccessful thus far. 2.5 minutes into the final period. Down by 3 goals, total goal series. Trailing 2-1 in tonight's game. Down the ice it goes, and icing is called by the linesman. Face off back to the left of Archer Irbe. Goal for the Soviets.
Here's one of the best passing plays all game long by Team USA as Breslin cuts in. He looks up, and who's there? Irbe. He moves out. He's very aggressive. And he hasn't made spectacular saves, but he's made smart plays. That was one of them, reading the rush by Tim Breslin out of Lake Superior State, who's a good scorer, having a good year, Don, but he was robbed.
Indeed he was. Tomatis for the Soviet Union takes a check from Taylor in the corner. Held to the point. Hahar's shot is wide, short side. U.S. buzzing around now in search of a goal to tie this game and get back into the series. Soviets bring it back to center ice. Soviet player sent flying in the center ice area. Opolsky left his feet. Now Moore. Taylor taken down inside the line. Play goes right on. Pavlov. Tomanis behind him. Makes the centering pass out in front. No shot possible there. Recovering for the United States is number 5, Jim Larkin. Wide open hockey. U.S. with nothing to lose. Down by 3 in the series as it stands. Pavlov, you go Pavlov, having to settle for a pass back to Sayas.
Pantaleov, number 30 on the ice, wearing a shield. He did not wear one last night. He's put one on for this game.
Enough of those sticks around the eyes. They'll get you to wear one in a hurry. See a lot of the Soviet players on the bench with cuts. Dangerously close to the eyes, some of them. There is the shield. They simply shoot it between the two blue lines, and back and forth they go. Erickson blocking it. No icing on the play. A little over 4 minutes gone on the final period.
Americans have registered the only 2 shots on goal so far in the third.
Ekrin down the left boards, can't handle the pass. Soviets now will test the waters. Karsh lets a shot go. Rebound from Erickson. Collected by his defense player, David Davila from Lake Superior State. Long pass trying to feed LeClaire. They get Ronan instead inside the line. Or McEkrin couldn't get it to him. Kept alive in the zone by Sikarski. Quick shot is blocked. Back from McClair. Gets up for the rebound, but gets taken down again. Here's a centering pass out for Sikarski. That goes wide. McEkrin puts it in front, and Ronan couldn't find it.
Well, the American player is looking for rebounds, all tied up by the 2 Soviet defensemen.
Quick shot, they score. The Soviets get an extra goal after 3 great chances for the United States. Karsh, it looks like.
Yes.
Puts it in to make it a 7-3 lead.
What a game he's had. He's been strong. The Americans had the goal-scoring chances, 2 or 3 of them, but Chudinov, number 7, and number 5, Zinoviev, with a great job defensively in front of Archer's ear bay. Now watch the release of this shot. That's what European players are noted for. He takes the pass in one motion, goes into the wrist shot, and beats Chad Erickson, who had good position, but he was beaten with a good shot. These European players, especially the Soviets, are so adept at shooting the puck off the pass, whether it be a slap shot or a wrist shot, and that was a great example of it. But again, Don, we'll mention about the fine defensive play as the Americans jammed the goal in front of Irbe. They couldn't get a clean shot because of that fine play.
So Alexander Karch with a goal last night adds 2 more tonight for 3 in this challenge series. The Soviets lead 7-3 overall, 3-1 on the night.
The Americans just simply, if you're dumping the puck in, keep it away from Irbe.
Here's Fandul, looks for Belyavsky, waits, shoots, puck's lost, but he gets the rebound and puts it in. Erickson couldn't find it for a moment, and the dangerous winger, Alexander Belyavsky, pounced on the rebound.
An example, Don, of Irbe. The puck was put down towards the Soviet netminder. See how he gets the puck? Now watch him quickly move it up ice. It traps everybody. Right away, the Soviets handle the shootout by the goaltender. Watch this pretty passwork inside the zone. Two quick passes and a rebound goal on Chad Erickson, who made a fine first save. Irbe's quickness of moving the puck out sets the Soviet team up, and you see their passwork starting to shine. They've had two strong third periods so far in this two-game tournament. They're looking pretty good.
Notice the poise of Beljavski, too, taking his time to make the first shot. Rebound is what put it in, but he did not lose his cool with a great chance in front of the net. So it's 4-1 on the night, 8-3 now. The total goal series. Soviets break it open, and they break it in again. Frostick comes, and Erickson is beaten one more time. That play was engineered by the Montreal draft choice, Vito Lynch. Made the pass, the relay for the ninth goal of the series.
Vito Lynch was injured last night. He suffered a cut to the inside of his thigh, but was able to play. And again, it's neutral zone play, it's counter plays. We talked about Team USA having to pinch to be aggressive in the offensive zone. It's costing them. And look at the poise and the quickness of the Dynamo Riga team. They're starting to roll. Erickson has to play the shooter, but the pass is allowed to be made across. Erickson had no chance. If he doesn't stay with the shooter would end up scoring.
So the Soviets break it wide open in 9-3 on the series. 14 minutes to go, and the game 5-1 is tonight's score.
Now for Team USA, it's time just to play smart, think about the defensive task, and try and take the body somewhat. That's one thing the Soviets have been able to do, except for there, is evade body checks.
That last goal credited to Opolsky at 5:38, his first of the series. Weak shot by Sayas, and the U.S. clears the zone. Three Soviet goals in 43 seconds here in this third period.
And all pretty goals, beautiful plays, to be honest. And it looks like the USA team is thinking about making a goal change as Tom Cole prepares himself on the USA bench.
It's no knock against Erickson, who's played well, but a chance to give Cole in this situation at least a little bit of action here. He's not seen any so far. Maher wins the race back for the puck. And then gets it ahead to McGuckin. For LeClaire, leaves it at center ice. LeClaire gets tied up with his numerical counterpart, Oleg Znarak. Across the line, LeClaire's shot. It's whistled out on the offside, 13:04 to go.
And we do have a goaltending change, Don, coming up now. Tom Cole will get his first international experience, an acrobatic-style goaltender moving in for USA.
Soviets 9 and the United States 3 in goal. Tom Cole now for Chad Erickson, his first appearance of the series from Northeastern University, a junior.
A physical education major from Woburn, Massachusetts, a 21-year-old, gets some action.
Sarsky shooting it down the near boards. Shooting off for the Soviet Union, kept in by number 7 of the United States, Sean Gorman from Princeton. The Americans let it all fly in the first 5 minutes and were made to pay the price for the Soviets. In once again on Cole. Rebounds, Narok. Cole, sliding save block that. Tested early. Close range. No warm-up for him coming in this situation. A non-injury situation. And Erickson leaving. Narok being watched by Gorman in behind. Rides him off into the boards. Sarsky. Naparella across the ice to the center ice area.
This line we see on the ice, Semeryak, Znarok, and Karch have had a strong game.
A strong series. Shooting off, lazily floats it down to the far corner of the United States. Plenty of speed really showing up now. Plenty of stamina left on the part of this visiting team from Riga in the Republic of Latvia. They bump in the corner, the referee, Matt Dunn, whistles it down.
I believe Znarok will get the penalty. He was working over Jim Dowd, who was down on his knees. I think that's the call, and we should see an American power play.
Yes, the Soviet will go to the penalty box. 11:51 left.
Tom Cole's first action came immediately after he went into the goal for Team USA. Good poke check, and then he recovers here. He's an acrobatic-styled goaltender, and you can see there the quickness worked as he robbed Znarok. Now here you'll see Jim Dowd go down. You'll see Znarok continue to work over Jim Dowd. So So he gets the penalty as the referee was right in the same corner watching.
So he kicked him as he had him tied up in the corner. So Znarok gets a roughing penalty with 11:51 to go. A 9-3 Soviet lead. Total goals in the series. Two games here in Orlando. David DeVita works it down the left side for the United States. McGekin line is up there now with Amati, and Rod Taylor makes an appearance back on the point. Taylor fails to hold it in. Soviets clear the zone. United States on the power play.
Think about European teams. All their players can play both the power play unit and the penalty killing unit. Oh boy, there's a high stick.
Kretowicz took a shot and he's still down.
Natitsin was standing up at the blue line, put a stick right into the face, it looked like, of Tretowitz, the defenseman. He's still down. Matitsin will put his team down two men now.
The linesman was very much concerned and got the trainer out in a hurry.
There you see Matitsin and the stick blade and shaft goes right into the throat of Tretowitz. And he is now gone. Now you'll see the defenseman reach out with his stick and you'll see Tretowitz cut to his right. And the stick will move right up. Boom. And I mean high and hard. And Tretowitz now up.
Happily,
moving,
yes.
Yes.
Off to the bench under his own power. It could have been a very serious incident. But he is all right. The senior from Clarkson University. Ice on that sore throat. Not a sore throat as you and I might know it.
Oh, boy. The trainer, by the way, is Carrie Di Benedetti out of Mahwah, New Jersey. And she was the trainer last year here for this series, which was in Orlando for the first game and Dallas for the second game. She's the head trainer at Mahwah, New Jersey High School. Graduated from the University of Colorado. Getting the job done on Tretowitz.
First lady I have seen as trainer for a hockey team. I'd say more of them. Yeah, that is a major penalty. And a misconduct penalty. Viewed that seriously by referee Matt Dunn, a deliberate attempt to injure.
Yes, it's a five-minute major and a game misconduct because of the major. Number 30, Pantaleov, will be over there to serve that penalty to Matitsin, who is gone. So he gets a five-minute cross-checking call and a game misconduct. So it's a five-on-three here now, Don.
Here's a two-man advantage for the U.S. in motion. Dowd back at the point, lets his shot go. That's blocked by Beryevsky. Over in the far boards. Amati from behind the net from McGekin. Taylor goes in to dig it out. He'll pass it in behind the net again. Amati over on the far side. Back on the right point as David DeVita can't control the puck. Forechecking is Beryevsky.
One area the Americans had a tough go. I've had a tough go in this two-game series. The five-on-three situations, they haven't been real precise and concise with their pass work and their movement and haven't scored. But I believe this is their third five-on-three situation in this series.
There's a look at the coach of the Soviet visiting team, Evald Grabowski. And for the United States, Mike Sertich from the University of Minnesota, Duluth.
He has Tim Army from Providence as his assistant. We should mention, too, that these Soviets play these tournaments very seriously, and the main reason is they get hard currency to take back home, which means a lot to those players.
Dowd makes the pass, hard shot by Amati. It's blocked by the side of the goal. Soviets pick it up. Taylor forechecking in there along with McGekin, but they do clear it.
Don, what they do is they take the hard currency, the American money, and they change it across to Swiss francs as they take it into the Soviet Union.
Yes, the ruble not worth much in the USSR.
Not worth anything anywhere else either.
Nothing elsewhere. Back when I was there, as you know, being there too, they even in the restaurants, if you order a beverage, they want a foreign currency, not their own.
Club soda costs a lot of money there too, huh?
Mm-hmm. You have to be very thirsty. Less than 10 minutes to go now in the third and final period of this challenge series. Americans, as John Davidson pointed out, laboring under two-man advantage once again. Certainly not dominating. Almost unsure as to what to do in this situation. The Soviets have been there before. They handled it well. They circled the net, and this time they pop it in. That was Taylor coming around to sweep it in.
Now, this is one time when Yerbe gets caught. He tried a sweeping poke check, and when he did it, he got caught because he missed the man with a puck, Taylor. And what happens is when you've extended your arms and sweeping your goal stick as a goaltender, you can't move your feet. And it took him a long time to get across from post to post. And by that time, the puck was put in off the side. Watch the sweeping poke check there. And Yerbe can hardly get across in time. Taylor certainly read the play, noticed the goaltender was slow getting across, and he banked it in off the left leg of Archer's Yerbe. A smart play by Rod Taylor. There's Yerbe trying to get across. Taylor had almost an impossible angle, so he banked it in. And the Ferris State player, Rod Taylor, scores, a senior at Ferris State. Rod Taylor gets a goal.
His first of this series. 9-4 now, total goals. 5-goal bulge for the Soviet Union. The assist came from DeVita and Jay Moore. The time was 10:30 of this final period. Here's a shot from the point, just going wide, from Tredowitz, who's back on the ice after that shot he took in the throat. Ronan down in the corner. Power play continuing for the United States. Trying to feed Ronan in front or Moore. Back to the point instead. Tredowitz shooting. Blocked in front. Rebound. They bang away. And Stedden couldn't get it past Yerbe. U.S. with a productive power play now. Still down by five with nine to go in Orlando.
Some more power play work. The Americans on the power play because of the major penalty. You see them jam the nets. Take the time. Fine pass across, the shot by Tredowitz, who drew the major, and Archer's Yerbe even had a rebound to work with, covered up smartly. By my calculations, Don, there's still 2 minutes and 12 seconds remaining to this American major power play.
Yes, they do not get off the hook, the Soviets, on a major once a goal is scored, so the U.S. with a chance to pull closer here. Pass just failed to click in front of the net, cleared by Grigoriev. Valyavsky now being hounded by Ronan. Tredowitz at his own blue line forms the play ahead for the United States with a one-man advantage over the Soviets, which continues. Yerbe in behind will clear it himself down the ice.
Remember, it's a major power play here, so the Americans can score and score and score, and the man cannot come out of the penalty box until a time on that major has expired.
This is Tredowitz once again. Icing is the indication, crossing the line, unlike the National Hockey League. You're going to have to go back and touch it to enforce icing. Once it goes over that back red line, the whistle is sounded.
Tredowitz just got caught on the ice a little long, was unable to complete the pass.
Over 2 minutes remaining in the United States power play.
So my calculations were wrong.
Somewhere between 2 and 3 minutes. You were right. Hey, you can't do it all.
There was 2:46 remaining.
Can't be timekeeper and expert analyst all in one night.
Forget the calculator and you're dead.
Puck is dropped. McKechnie with it, leaving it there for his teammate Brett Harkins from Bowling Green. Across the ice for David DeVita. Now Amonte. Making his moves in center ice. Yerbe out to collect it with Harkins closing in.
This is a play that is not allowed in North American hockey. The goaltender skating outside the goal crease, grabbing the puck and causing a stoppage. In European hockey, it is allowed. And Yerbe, smart to leave and cause the stoppage. Don, you'll see some advertising on the back of these Soviet jerseys. It says Astro Gallery Chicago. Nobody knows what it is. We phoned up to Chicago, checked information out. There's no such place. The coaching staff was laughing about it. Gallery Astra in Chicago, and nobody seems to know anything about it. Perhaps these coaches for the Soviet Union cut a deal, and they're getting something that nobody seems to know anything about. They were laughing about it, but nobody can figure it out.
What they did, though, is only provide the sponsor one set of jerseys. That was a problem last night when both turned up with white. The Soviets had no alternative, so the U.S. had some blue sweaters shipped in today, so they're a lot easier to distinguish out there. Here's Tavares now, waiting to make his play inside the line. It's a pretty one, and Cole just keeps it off the short side.
See a different style with Cole. He moves across feet first. Erickson's the goaltender, moves across staying on his feet.
Yeah, he's much more acrobatic, the young man from Northeastern University, in the nets right now for the United States. Cabanas one more time, dropping it back for Pavlov, checked in there by David DeVita. Seyus keeps it alive for the Soviet team. Pavlov bodied by DeVita. And Ekrin comes in to beat Dowd. This is Jim Dowd, leaving it for his defenseman DeVita. He'll leave the ice, having shot it down behind the Soviet goal. 7 minutes left in the third period. 5 goals, the Soviet lead of the total goal series. The United States trying to cut it down there. That sweeping pass and shot by Larkin. Irbe flags it down and shoots it right back to the United States zone. Shot from the point. Cole got back and reacted to that drive from Ketlitz.
Good low shot. Cole tried to move the puck up the ice. There he is talking to his teammate about the pass that didn't work. He's talking it over to Sean Gorman. Here's Katlaps getting the puck after the goaltender had moved it up ice. And he makes a fine save. Established good position. Was way out for that shot from the blue line. Put the rebound into the stands. Plays in a very good summer league in the Boston area, which a lot of college players and professional players play in to stay in shape during the offseason.
Still 30 seconds left in this major power play advantage for the United States, which so far has produced one goal. Ronan at center ice has to wait now. Collects it again. I'm ticking down, however, in the Soviet penalty. Ronan down the left board. Larkin pursues it in the corner against Seyus. Almost gave it away. Did to Ronan. Makes the pass in front. Couldn't clear through the defense player's legs. The Soviets pick it up. Pavlov with it now in the center ice area. And the power play has expired. It cost the Soviets just the one goal. 9-4 is the score in the series. Quick shot wide of Cole's net. 6 minutes to go now in the third period. Teeth sent on the ice. They roll it ahead, and it's forced to the doorstep of Cole, almost pushed in by Zdarok.
Well, you've called his name a lot in this game.
The most ice time of any Soviet by far. Takes a belt there, a helmet flying, taken down, no penalty call. Play goes right on. Headman the puck to Taylor. He's got a breakaway. Taylor going in, backhands it, and he's robbed by Irbe.
It was Taylor with that big, hard body check that knocked Snarok down, which created the turnover. Then Taylor went off ice and took the pass for the breakaway. Taylor was towards the end of a shift, though, Don. Couldn't really make the great play.
Snarok, without the helmet, takes another hit from Taylor in the United States zone. Wide open, devil may care hockey as they play it into the corner of the net. The Soviets score again.
No, I don't think it went in. I think it went off of both goal posts.
The light is gone.
The light is on. The referee, though, was waving no goal with both hands. He was waving it off, or appeared to be. The puck did hit both goal posts, and I believe Cole hung onto it. Taylor had some kind of shift. Let's look at the end of this play. It'll catch the goal post to our left and then move across.
Look at that.
To the other one.
Along the
and
line.
It stays out. That actually went off of the player's, Narok's, foot first. It will hit his foot and then both goalposts. So even if it goes in, it should be disallowed. Watch Narok hit his skate with it, redirect it off of both goalposts.
Yeah.
And Cole had presence of mind to hang on. It never did cross the line. And remember,
amazing.
The entire puck has to cross the
absolutely
line.
Absolutely. It's no goal.
So this goal judge, who doesn't get a lot of hockey action, a little trigger happy,
yeah.
Huh? Faceoff outside the USA zone. Great body check during that shift by Taylor. He nailed Snarok, and that's why he played the entire shift without his helmet.
Referee moves. No goal. Puck was kicked into the net.
Well, they're announcing he was kicked into the net. That hasn't happened yet.
It was
kicked along the red line, but not over it. Remaining 9-4 with 5:09 to go. Dmitry Zinoviev. That wicked shot of his. Sarsky ahead for the United States. For Tim Breslin. Works it inside the line. Down the boards, trying to feed Dowd. Zinoviev slashes away at him, wins the puck. Soviets bring it out. Van Duel, left side pass. Right winger stayed back on the point, couldn't get in there. Now Pandua will let his shot go. Trickles to Cole. The goal stick blocks that rebound. Cut right in front. It's there in the crease. Cole finds it at last. 4:33 remaining now, the final period here of this two-game challenge series. Hope you've enjoyed the action the last couple of nights on the Prime Network from Orlando in Florida. Everything but hockey weather outside, but in here it looks like a normal arena, normal situation for this great game. Shots on goal, U.S. with a slight edge in this period.
This series has drawn about 6,000 people per game, so 12,000 enjoying two nights of action.
Taking time off from their Christmas shopping to be here. It'll be a warm Christmas in Florida. Low 80s forecast next week.
I don't know how you handle that. Isn't that something? Just my goodness.
Just pretend the sand is snow. It's easy.
By the way, for hockey fans, I'll mention in a moment.
Yavsky with the puck for the Soviets. Makes the shot. Couldn't get it away anyway. And the good check there by Mahar.
I'm going to give a Mario Lemieux update. He started working today, both riding the stationary bike and some stretching. Plans to walk in the pool this week as we have a penalty coming up against the Soviet Union. Boldashenko will get the penalty right moving up as he moves in. Wow, what a hard hit that was. Jay Moore. Boldashenko hitting behind the play gets a call for interference.
Forceful interference, you might call it.
These Soviet players have played tough, just like the Americans. Again, we'll mention that this Soviet team is strongly suited to North American style. One of the two teams that plays that way in the Soviet Union.
So the U.S. will whip the puck around on the power play as best they can. Moore, who took the hit that caused the penalty, tries to flip it in front. It's Ronan out there with it, and he couldn't get it in.
Archer Zierbe reached out with a catching glove, grabbed hold of it. Zierbe, the goaltender, Don, it was interesting as a youngster, was a forward, but suffered a fractured leg. He decided that skating wouldn't be the best part of his game after the bad fracture. He decided to play goal. He was 12 years old when that happened, and he certainly made the right decision. Noted as a great goaltender.
Dowd shoots wide and over top. Play continues in the Soviet zone. Dowd plays it across the side of the net, intercepted there by Soviet defender Konstantin Grigoryev. Down the ice it goes. How about you as a kid? Was it goaltending all the way?
No, I was a forward till I was about 12 or 13 years of age. And our goaltender got hurt, took a chance at it, enjoyed it actually for the most part. Great position to play when things go well.
Was an astute move as things turned out. In come the Soviets again. Alexander Alexeyev with it, drifts it wide. Ed Ronan brings it ahead with 2:45 to go on the hockey game. He has Amane with him and McEachran. McEachran couldn't get the play. Gets bumped off the puck into the corner by Seuss. Soviet's going to break here. Siflakov. The last moment is met by a sliding Gorbin with the rebound. He pokes in with determination. The 10th goal for the Soviet Union.
And when you watch these Soviets play, you have to admire the fact that they can change direction quickly. And here we see Siplikov when he moves into the offensive zone. Watch how quickly he cuts to his left and the little space he uses. He looks to his left. Now watch the stop there and a quick turn. That's a marvelous talent. And then he's able to keep his balance enough to get the rebound and backhanded pass Tom Cole, who was aggressive on the play. Just watch this quick move. Stop, quick left move. Now he's set up for the play offensively. They're a marvelous talent when you watch them play. Individually, great skills. And when they get their five-man units going, you can see why this country has been so successful with international hockey.
Since the mid-1950s, 1954, with a big upset to win the World Championship over Canada, they've been a dominant force in this game. The assist on that last goal going to Igor Pavlov. Siplikov, of course, the score. 2 minutes and a dozen seconds left as the United States force it back to the Soviet zone. Hirbe, who loves to clear the puck, does not quite get it out of the zone, but now they bring it forward for him. Karch with it. Two goals tonight, three in the series, falling on the play to the American corner. Left for Jay Moore. Taylor on his left, breaks to center ice. Moore inside the blue line, fading off of the boards now, feeding Taylor in front, couldn't get a good shot away to drift wide. Snedden with it. Karch ties him up. Now Chudinov comes in to assist. The Soviets bring it forward again with a minute and 35 seconds to go. Zarok gets a shot away on the relay in front. Moore with it on the far boards. Intercepted. Zarok everywhere for the Soviet team tonight. Armin Seyus recovering back behind his own goal. A minute and 15 seconds remain.
The two wingers, Karch and Znarok, with the centerman, Semeryak, have had an outstanding game. As a unit, they've worked well. They've handled the puck through the neutral zone, made offensive plays. And this Soviet team has not faded at all in the six periods of play.
They are unbeaten on their tour of major U.S. college teams and this U.S. select team so far. Tony Amate has been named the Budweiser player of the game for the United States. Dangerous forward, has been everywhere in the ice.
It's important for him after being ejected last night.
There's a score, quick shot. The U.S. collects one more before sundown. Blasted by Breslin.
The faceoff, won by Dowd. The shot. Don, I believe the puck was rolling, went off the goalpost, beating Yerbe. And it's not too often in a game you see Yerbe get beaten for three goals. Here's the draw, smart win. The puck is rolling. The screen shot off the goalpost. An accurate shot by Breslin, considering the puck was rolling. You'll see him just move into the shot. A good pick on the play by Naparella to hold up the winger moving out. Good shot by Breslin, who's a very aggressive player at both ends of the ice. He can play center or left wing. And on that play, the left winger scores.
Dowd gets the assist. 18:48. We come down now to the final minute of the series. It's on Cole's doorstep. Relaying it off the boards and out to center ice. 10-5 now, total goals, the Soviet lead. Big check on the boards. Their Soviet player, Bereznev, felt that. Zarok on the far side. It's whistled down. There'll be a holding call from referee Matt Dunn.
On the far side of the ice, all the players skating around. I think Dowd, yes, Dowd now going to the penalty box. So within the last minute, the Soviets, who have 10 in this series, there's Dowd trying to hold up Opalski.
Doing a pretty fair job,
yes,
of it.
Created the turnover, made the turnover by holding up Opalski.
USA penalty to number 9, Jim Dowd. 2 minutes holding time on penalty.
The Soviet Budweiser player of the game, Alexander Kerch, with two goals tonight. His second and third of the series, getting one last night on the 4-2 win.
Very fast, very skilled puck handler. Very good from start to finish in this outing. Stays on the ice for the power play with his line mates, who have been very, very good. Znarok and Semeryak. As you see, Dowd in the accommodating to the fans, signing an autograph. I think you'll see Jim Dowd play a lot of hockey representing the American international teams in the future. He's a skilled player out of New Jersey.
Number four on this team out of Lake Superior State. Soviets at the 35 seconds of remaining mark of time. Zarok feeding it back to Chudinov, keeping it alive. The Soviet defense player flips it across to the other point man with a big shadow. Doesn't take it. Zanafiev now to Chudinov. Chudinov stick check by Roden. Roden can't dig it free. Znarok keeps it in for the Soviet Union. 18 seconds to go. Semeryak with it. Back to Chudinov. 10 seconds remaining. Here's the big shot. Cole is equal to that challenge.
Got another one of those set plays by the Soviets. Number 5, Zinoviev, waiting for the pass. You'll see the Soviets, and if people scout this Riga team, that is the story of their power play. They work the puck along this side of the ice to draw the Americans over. Then with this pass, they set up for the big shot. The puck rolls again, so we didn't get a lot on it. But that's the main play they've used in the two games. And if people are to play this team in the future, scouting and watching, that is their power play play.
Yeah, when Zinoviev gets that shot off of your goaltender, you better hope the puck is rolling or else he breaks the stick and doesn't get any wood on it, because he can bring it. 6,017, the official attendance here tonight. Down to the final 5 seconds we go. The United States playing it back to center. Shooting off of the Soviet Union, and that will do it as the two-game challenge series ends with the Soviet Union winning last night 4-2 and going on to an eventual total goals victory with a 6-3 final score tonight of 10-5 total goals for the two nights of hockey. Well-played, entertaining hockey, I might add, here in Orlando. So with a year and a couple of months to go before the challenge of the Olympics in Albertville, France, the United States is off to a decent start. Probably 4 or 5, maybe 6 of these players could make the Olympic team. That's the expectation. 10-5 is the final score for the Soviet Union over the USA Selects in Orlando.